Welcome back to another weekly Daily Wednesdays where we sit back, relax, take that midweek break, talk about some of the fun things going on in the world of Linux and open source. And Ben Stone joined every week by Jill Bryant. And with our powers combined, also, we got Shadow Realm hanging out over on Twitch, talking the bits we were just talking about, you know, playing some video games in the day and like the new Star Wars and all that. Go give that a listen if you want, if you are a patron. But let's go ahead and jump into it for this week with five things to consider before picking your first Linux distro, not your 13th.
Yes.
No, no, no. Not your last.
But your first.
Yeah.
So for me and Ben, who have actually been using Linux since its inception, it's, you know, easy for us to choose a Linux distro. In fact, we've used most of them. But for new people to Linux, it is a lot more challenging because there are so many options to consider. And this was a cool article by Dibaker Ghosh. Excuse me if I don't say your name right. Dibaker Ghosh over at How to Geek breaks it down really nicely into what to consider before picking your first Linux distro. And he breaks it down to five things to consider, which I was really impressed with. The first consideration is, how do you want to interact with your distro? Or what user interface would you like to use? There are actually
That's wonderful. We're going to stop right here because there's a big note on the page, Jill Bryant.
Oh,
what you see happened? That? It's in yellow. And it says, not all Linux distros come with a DE, desktop environment pre-installed. And like Arch Linux and Debian lack both a desktop environment and a GUI. You got to set them up yourself. And that's why beginners should avoid these distros. My man, if you're going to get something wrong, you probably don't want to highlight how wrong you are with a note, because you're incorrect. Like, there's no discussing that whatsoever. Debian does not like desktop environments. It ships with several. It even has a GUI for installation. GNOME is the default desktop manager, and it's selected for you by default during the install. So if you're going to be in error, don't highlight it. I don't know about Arch.
but you know, they're of course with the GUIs, you know, we should check out the most popular ones first that most people use on a day-to-day basis and are easy to use, like the one many you probably have heard of, like GNOME, KDE Plasma, or Cinnamon. Those are good choices for new people coming to Linux. The Cinnamon desktop on Linux Mint is wonderful. GNOME on Ubuntu, and KDE Plasma, Fedora is really nice.
What do you look for when you're shopping around for a distro, Jill? Like, what do you think?
I think for me, the number one is stability, really. I think because of all the years using Linux, I was doing a professional animation and graphics, and I needed stability. And even now, you know, on my rig, right now doing you know, podcasting, I'm using Ubuntu, a Debian based distro, and I like it because of its stability, and I don't have to worry about things breaking and having to do updates every other week or every week. So
what do we think about different types of installers, because I think that is probably going to be one of the first things that you want to look for. Linux distribution, like, how user-friendly? Because you want to talk about frustrated. Watch me install Fedora. Actually, you know what? Fedora's not too bad. I don't like Fedora's partitioning manager.
Didn't like it. Now, it can be even a little buggy at times.
I don't have any problem with the bugs with it. I didn't like the way it was constructed. And it was way too much in my way, and it took me a minute. Now I figured it out. And by figured it out, that means that I spent twice as long messing around with it, clicking on things on and off until I got it to work versus just checking the documentation like I should have. But I thought compared to like Debian is like old school. That's why I like the old school, because I grew up doing that. But that's not going to be familiar with a lot of people. Like, just the idea of booting into a live distribution, I understand that's a good thing, right? You got some things to say about that, don't you? Like, with like live USBs, just pop those guys in.
Yeah, in fact, that's the way I like to test new distros. You can also test them with a virtual machine as well, but I still prefer doing it on a USB flash drive. So you're testing those distros on bare metal.
It's a good idea to do that because then you know whether or not it's going to work. Because then you're going to run into like different bugs and different problems. Leave me a comment. Like, I want to know, like, what do you look for? Unless you're just a habitual distro hopper, which means no, I don't mean this in a bad way at all. That means that Linux is your hobby, not your operating system, which is perfectly fine. Accept it, own it. Don't let anybody ever tell you that there's a problem with that.
Mm-hmm.
But for those of you out there that are like, I would need Linux to be my operating system. You know, you don't wipe your operating system. Like, you know, you make the analogy of like, well, I installed Windows 10, Windows 11. No, you don't do that. You have like your main operating system that you use day in and day out. What are your decisions with that?
Yeah.
What are your thoughts? Like, is it hardware support? But is that really a thing in 2024? Pretty much everything just kind of works out of the box these days.
It does, except for like specific laptops that are kind of made in the last, with certain chipsets made in the last few years. But that's why we have rolling releases of Linux to support that, generally supports that hardware first before everyone does.
I know, like back in the day, Mint, wait till I write it on Mint, because Mint had really good hardware support.
Yeah.
But then again, Mint was based on Ubuntu. Ubuntu had really good hardware support. Probably still does.
It's even better now because they're using the latest kernel releases. So that's been very exciting. Yeah, we're getting you know, recent kernels for that hardware enablement is wonderful.
Love to see it. So like, let me know what you look for. I saw Don, he chimed in, you know, Debbie and Ubuntu pop. Good times. All right.
That's awesome.
Now, this is not so much about the Raspberry Pi 0W2. This is the Raspberry Pi Pico, no 0, no W, but Jill, there's a 2.
Yes, there is. The Raspberry Pi Pico 2 has been released with some very welcome changes. The form factor is as similar as possible to the original Raspberry Pi Pico, so it is a compatible drop-in replacement. And that was good to hear. We don't want the form factor to change to make it easy for hobbyists and IoT projects upgrades. But what's really cool is it has a new RP203050 chipset, and they are RISC-V based as well. And there are two M33 processor cores running at 150 megahertz, which is actually twice as fast as the original RP2040 chipset from the original Raspberry Pi Pico. And it's got 520 kilobytes of on-chip SRAM and 26 multi-purpose GPIO pins. And it's available like the original Raspberry Pi Pico for only $5 from the usual Raspberry Pi approved sellers linked in our show notes. And one thing I wanted to say is they were talking about in the article about how this was the chip for the Pico that the Raspberry Pi wanted to create. This is the, you know, revision of the original one that they wanted, something that was you know, lower power but faster. So it was a big advancement to their chipset for the Raspberry Pi Pico 2.
I'm always curious to see what people are always, they're just playing around with the Pi Picos like that. I don't have any particular use cases for the Pico. The original Pico has all been like, hey, cool, Arduino type thing from Pi. Yeah. I'm like, kinda. Maybe a little more powerful, but you know, you got a hazard 3 RISC-V in there, which is something to play around with.
Yeah.
I don't have, you know, along with those dual Cortex M33s, you're not going to be running X on it. Probably not going to be running Steam. But if you're doing something like quasi-embedded, let me know in the comments. I'm curious what you want to play around with. And, you know, it's a step down from, you don't need, it's hard to get your in the right headspace because a lot of people will look at like a Raspberry Pi 4, Raspberry Pi 5. You're like, that's pretty cut down desktop. So it's kind of hard to look at something like a Raspberry Pi Zero and go, that's just too much power. I need something a little cut down because I've been screaming left and right with I've been dealing with a 512 megabyte RAM constraint this week.
And the compilation is still going on.
Compared to like what you would have to deal with. But I like the challenge. I like the challenge. And you know, this has a fraction of that. Really cool. Really cool.
Yeah.
Love to see it. $5. Go buy one. Do what I did with the original Pi Zero. Just buy one because it's $5. You never know. Now, let's rip the lid off of a Raspberry Pi. C1 versus D0. We talked about the Raspberry Pi 5, the cut down version that you shouldn't notice because they did their best to cut down the parts that they weren't using on the chip because they can get them a little bit cheaper, pass the savings on to you. You know, what was it? A $50 Pi, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Only $50.
That's
pretty sweet.
Not too bad. Well, old Jeff got a hold to it and he did confirm that the new stepping, the D0, is the die size 32.5% smaller now. How did he do that? Well, if we scrolled, he took a razor blade to it. You madman. Mm-hmm. You wacky, wacky, wacky human being. I can respect that. I mean, I would do that if I had like two of them.
Yeah, yeah.
One of them would be danger Pi. I'd be like, you know what? I don't, no big deal if something happens to you. I got backup Pi right over here. Now, we did learn a few things, though. Because he went through this, you know, he did all the measurements. There it is, delidded right there. When he was cooling it, did he have like a pelter hooked up? Some, you know, Pi silliness, that what people do.
Yeah.
There it is with no lid on it. And apparently it runs just fine without the integrated heat spreader on it. But you probably don't want to do that. If some of you of a certain age are having like flashbacks from the flip chip AMD days, and two of those I cracked over the time. But 2 gigs of RAM. Now, Jill, you mentioned it too, and I mentioned it up here at the top. Like, let's do some benchmarks. Now, something I like to run, I did it in my review of the 705, that HP Elite desk, was to run Geekbench, just so I could say in the video and be like, I look forward to people saying Geekbench is not a real benchmark. And sure enough, they were like, hi, I'm here to let you know that. I'm like, of course you are. But you know what? It works. Except it didn't work on this Pi, Jill.
Mm-hmm.
Why not? What happened?
Why not? So, as Jeff Geerling discovered, that Geekbench needs more than 2 gigabytes of RAM to run. And he had to use Sysbench instead for all his stats. And he even states, apparently Geekbench likes more than 2 gigs of RAM. I couldn't get past the multi-core photo filter test, since the OS kept running out of memory. A lot of software nowadays is built for an absolute minimum of 4 or 8 gigs. So keep that in mind when you're buying buying a Pi. And Vin and I had mentioned to make sure that the 2 gig of RAM Raspberry Pi 5 would work for your use case, and that the software you need would run with that limitation. You know, just because software is terminal based doesn't mean that it won't use lower RAM. And that's a truism. And yeah, we had talked about the release of the $50 Raspberry Pi 5 2 gig version 2 weeks ago. So it was nice to see Jeff Geerling's breakdown, because he did such an awesome job doing all the testing and seeing what the real differences were. It's half the size
of
the chipset. Yeah,
it is. It's definitely smaller. So what's the, I got to thinking about these two different, the C1 and D0 from Broadcom. I'm like, why are we really doing this? Why are we getting this like specialized like 2 gig? You know, you got to look through the marketing material and like, yeah, we're doing it. It's a lower. Oh, I know it's for money. We've established that, right?
Yeah.
Because you know, Raspberry Pi, they did their IPO and they're like, we're corporate now. Ha ha ha. Which isn't always a bad thing, until it is. Now, this isn't a bad thing. Let me tell you what's going on with this. Cost saving, man. You know, they trimmed this thing down. They're like, there shouldn't be any differences with the stepping. There shouldn't be. But we need to make sure. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to put it on a $50 2 gig version and let y'all play with it. See how that works out. Because I'm just saying, and I'm spitballing here, I wouldn't be surprised if we saw this make its way into the 4 and 8 gig models.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, Jeff was saying that they stripped out the network chipset that was in there.
Yeah, that's a thing, man. Good job on everything with that, Jeff. Love to see it. Keep it up. One thing I definitely want to see later on down the road is somebody just sticking these things right next to each other in a simple to read chart and just like all the way down and like just make sure everything works, because I don't really keep up with it. I found the Raspberry Pi 5 to be not a very good value. for what it is. I'm not the only one. You know, it's not like big mean Ven is like, no, everybody else did too. But, you know, it's new. It's something to play with. It's a bit late. A little overpriced. This is a little cheaper, though. And if you're looking for that 2 gig sweet spot, which even Jeff said is like, that's tough. That's tough constraint, which, depending on your use case, might be, might not be. So there we go, ladies and gentlemen. All right. So I do want to thank, I saw Don roll by with 45 months here on Twitch. Thanks for the gift sub. Last night, anonymous person. I don't know who you are, but they don't donate a 10. So if you just happened to be in chat last night, you got access to our super secret Discord, and you can come play some Trackmania with us on Tuesdays and Fridays. If you feel so inclined, head over to Linux Gamecast, get the show notes, download the podcast. If you are a patron, thank you. Stick around for your name in the credits. But if you're not, you're missing out on some things. Live and uncut versions, and not just this show. We got Linux Gamecast weekly. We got the pre super shows, and get a downloadable, commercial-free video version of all the shows, live and uncut. Get them while they're still at room temperature. You don't want to get them when they're cold. You ever try to watch cold video? It's not a good thing. Patreon.com/Linux Gamecast. Appreciate your support. But until next week, get out there. What do they do, Joe? What do they do when they get outside? Touch grass?
And make something fun with Linux. Aw, thank you to our advisors, our Theron, our executive producers like Drummer, Barbrandt, Scott, our Chicago Kicks something, Empty K-Cyclism, our Sea Monsters, Diazine G. Joe, Veritanuda, our Death Notes, Leonardo Dodger, Nubbin, Turnover. And thank you, Don M., for the resub. That was a 45-month resub.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it was brilliant. Have a great rest of your week. See you next time.